Praise the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, today we just heard the beginning of a long prayer which Jesus did for his disciples. And this is a very important passage because this is where Jesus is praying in front of his disciples publicly. And it's a long prayer. In the Bible, we see so many prayers: prayer of Moses, prayer of Solomon, prayer of Abraham, prayer of David, prayer of Ruth, prayer of Esther, prayer. So many prayers, very important prayers in the Old Testament. And even in the beginning of the Gospels, we also know the prayer of Magnificat, Our Lady's prayer, Zechariah's prayer. So many prayers. So prayers are very important in the Bible because many secret theology is involved in it. If you look carefully, the prayer of our Lord Jesus Christ, there are so many themes in that prayer. The whole chapter of Gospel of John, chapter 17, there are lots of theme in this prayer. And the most important themes I would like to share with you. First one, again and again, Jesus is addressing Father, Heavenly Father, my Father, Father. So it means the whole prayer is addressed to the Heavenly Father. And he calls God my Father. Jesus called God as a Father. It is for the first time in the history of humanity, we human beings are asked by God himself to call God our Father. No other religion speak like this. In every religion so far until then, God is the creator and we are the creatures. God is the master of the universe and we are slaves. We are just creatures. We are living at the mercy of God. If you do something wrong, God will punish. If you are good, God will give you some gifts. So this is how every human being understood about God. Even in the Old Testament, if you read in the Old Testament, before Jesus Christ, even Israelites, they also had a notion about God like this. God is like the master and they are slaves. Even today, majority of the prominent religions consider God is the creator, master, the powerful one and all these things. And human beings are just creature or slaves, ordinary people living at the mercy of God. But when Jesus came, Jesus revealed who God the Father is. God is who God is. And Jesus said, God is your loving Father in heaven and you're all children. Now we have a relationship with God. That is why human beings are different from other creatures. The animals, they have no developments. Dogs, cats and all, from the beginning they are like this and they continue like this. But human beings, we have so many things special. We are special creatures in the whole universe. We are controlling the whole universe because God is giving us gifts each day, every day, because we are children. Since we are children, we have a special love. God has got a special love for us. Since we are children, there is a relationship. Therefore, every sin you commit, it hurts God. And he will try to come and save you. He will never come and punish you. He may discipline you, but he will never come and punish you. But he will try to save you. So that is what we need to understand about God. So the first theme that is very common in this prayer addressed is Jesus is calling God my Father, Heavenly Father. That is the first theme. And the second theme that you can see in this whole chapter is about the name should be honored. The name of God should be honored. Jesus said, your name I honored, I glorified your name. Your name should be honored. Name means the nature. Name is not only the, Jesus said, I revealed your name to my disciples. What does it mean? Jesus revealed the nature of God in front of all human being. Jesus revealed, I have made your name known to those whom you have given me. So what is the name of God? So if you want to know the name of God, Jesus is the name of God. What is Jesus? Jesus means his whole personality, the whole character, the whole nature is the name of God. If you really want to understand the real name of Jesus, real name of God, then understand prodigal son story. That is the name of God. So when you believe in God means believe in the whole nature, character, understanding, knowledge of God. So for example, when you say Father Joseph Edad, that's me. So what is Father Joseph Edad? I'm not talking about who is Father Joseph Edad. What is Father Joseph Edad? That means it's not just a picture. If you get a picture of Father Joseph and this is Father Joseph Edad, you may say, but that is not Father Joseph Edad. That's only the photo of him. So the same way, What is Father Joseph Haddad means the whole personality, the whole character, the whole nature, all what I am and what I have spoken, everything together is that name, Father Joseph Haddad. The same way, the name of God means is not just one name, but the whole personality, character, nature, everything which is revealed through Jesus Christ. So Jesus, we can call revelation of the name of God. So Jesus is revealed to us. And it is the whole name of Jesus, name of God. So Jesus said, I revealed your name to these people. So what is that character, nature of God? Then look at Jesus. Who is God? Look at Jesus. If you really want to understand how God behaves, look at Jesus. How God looks like, look at Jesus. How God shows his compassion, mercy, look at Jesus. So that is what the name of God. Praise the Lord. So this is something very important secret. So that is the second point. He revealed the name, glorified the name of God among the human beings. That is the second theme. And the third theme that you can see is kingdom of God. I have come to establish the kingdom of God. The concerns about the kingdom of God is there in the revealed in this prayer. Kingdom of God. That he is establishing a kingdom. And the fourth point that we can see in this prayer is deliver us from evil one. So I pray for these people. Jesus said, I pray for these people. So that they may be delivered. I'm not praying for everyone. I'm praying for those whom you have given to me. And I pray for them so that evil one should not touch them. So Jesus is praying for deliverance. Deliver them from evil one. So this is the content, the basic content. These are the basic content of these people. I mean, the prayer which Jesus prayed. Gospel of John chapter 17, the whole chapter. And if you take this content, first one, address to the Heavenly Father. Second one, the name of God should be honored. Third one, the concerns about the kingdom of God. Fourth one, deliverance from the evil one. When I say these four points, you will remember some other prayer. The prayer, Our Father. The prayer which Jesus taught the disciples. This content of the Our Father prayer is also almost same. Our Father in heaven. That's the first sentence. Our Father in heaven. And then the name of God should be honored. The kingdom of God should come down. And deliverance from the evil one. All these themes are there in the Our Father prayer. In a way, we can say, this prayer of Jesus is a detailed prayer of our Father. The prayer of Jesus which Jesus spoke, Gospel of John chapter 17, is the detailed prayer of our Father prayer. Jesus taught us to pray our Father prayer, and now he is doing the same prayer, but in a different format. What is the different format here? Here, there is no superiority or inferiority. I mean, inferior praying to the superior. That is not seen in this prayer. But if you look into this prayer, you can see mostly is a co-equality. You can see someone speaking to another person who is equal to each other. If you read the whole gospel, especially this whole passage, you can see this message is hidden inside. Co-equality of the speaker is seen in the whole prayer. Praise the Lord. Let's take one by one these passages. Let's just go through maybe one or two sentences from these passages if there is time. Let's go through these. Let's read Gospel of John chapter 17 verse 1 onwards. Let us read this word of God. Jesus, we read like this. Jesus lifted up. As Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven. So, you know, according to Jewish understanding, heaven means sky. When we say in the Bible, they have different understanding. They have, especially they mention about three heavens. The first heaven is the sky which you see in the daylight. That is the blue sky that you can see in the daylight. That is they call first heaven. In the night, you see the stars. They say it is second heaven, where the stars and other things are seen. The third heaven means beyond stars, beyond this cosmos. That is called the third heaven for them, according to Jewish normal ordinary people's understanding about heaven. So that is why the moment they look, somebody look up, that they say they're looking up heaven. So that is why Jesus looked up to heaven and prayed. There is a difference between the Eastern spirituality and Western spirituality. In the Eastern spirituality, especially in the time of Jesus and the place where Jesus was, when they pray, they look up towards heaven. But in Western spirituality, when they pray, they bow down and close the hands and hold the hands like this and look down and pray. This is a difference of theologies or difference of understanding. But during the time of Jesus, Jesus looked up towards heaven and prayed. And remember, it also shows the posture which you are using in prayer is very important. If you look into the Bible, many passages, we can see Jesus looking up to heaven and pray. Let's read John chapter 11, verse 41. We read like these, so they took away the stone and Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. So Jesus is looking upward and praying. Mark 7:34, the word of God again says another passage, then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Ephphatha, when he was praying, healing a person, Jesus looked up and prayed. So looking up is also a sign that there is somebody who is watching over us. There is someone who is above us and there is someone who is bigger than us. So that is what that is the body language of that prayer. When we look up, that means we are accepting that we are inferior. We are smaller than in front of that person. That is why people look up and pray. Praise the Lord. So these postures in the prayer is very important, because even in the Psalms you can see, lift up your hands and pray, stand up and pray, kneel down and pray, bow down and pray. So all these postures are mentioned during the prayer. Especially in the Bible, these postures are very important, because even when Jesus prayed many times, the postures of Jesus is very much written there. Jesus bowed down in Gethsemane and prayed. He knelt down and prayed. And so many examples you can see from the Bible. Therefore, when you pray, it is good to have a reverential posture, more than all the comfortable posture, but reverential posture. So that is very important. When we sit for prayer, the priority should be given not for comfort, but for reverence. The way you sit, the way you pray, the way you hold the hands, the way you move, that should make others also to feel that you are standing in front of somebody who is almighty. Sometimes the way we behave as if there is nobody almighty around. So if you really believe there is an almighty God in front of us, it will be shown in our body language, in our postures, in our positions. Therefore, whenever you come in front of the Blessed Sacrament, whenever you come in front of the worship, adoration, live streaming, even if it is at home, it is good to have a good posture, good way of position. Your dress and everything should be proper, because maybe, you know, sometimes we are at home and not watching live streaming and in front of the Blessed Sacrament, bowing down and praying and all. So sometimes we think, oh, nobody's watching me and my family members, so let me just lie down and watch, or just eat and watch. And we do all these things. That means the way, how much we give seriousness for this prayer. How serious we are about this live streaming. How serious we are about this adoration, this Blessed Sacrament, this blessing. That is shown in your body language. Therefore, if you are coming for live streaming and attending the live streaming or any prayer, make sure this body language, the reverential body language, should be there, because that is a clear sign that we believe Jesus is there. Otherwise, the way we people attend the live streaming, as if they believe Jesus is not there, but the TV and internet is there. So this kind of attitude will not bring any kind of blessing. If you really believe Jesus is there, the Almighty God, it should be shown on your body, in your behavior, in your postures. So please do be very careful about these, especially when we are at home and attending any spiritual services. Praise the Lord. So Jesus looked upward. Continue reading Gospel of John chapter 17 verse 1. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked upward to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. So until then, Jesus was saying, the Son of Man's hour has not come. The hour has not yet come. So that is what Jesus used to say. But now Jesus said, Father, the hour has come. What is that hour means? The hour means the Last Supper, the Gethsemane experience, the betrayal, passion, carrying of the cross, death of Jesus on Mount Calvary, and resurrection. This all together is called the hour. The hour has come. Now glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. You know, what does it mean? Glorify your Son means, glorifying the Son means, accept this. Accept all what I do, so that, you know, you will be accepted by everyone. So that is the meaning of it. For example, my dear brothers and sisters, suppose you have a son and he went for Olympics and he got 5 gold medals. And then he became very famous and all the media, press, everyone came to your home. And he's asking for an interview with you. And suddenly you say, what happened? Then they said, your son got 5 medals. Then you said, so what? As if you are not interested. As if you are not accepting it. As if you are not believing it, or as if you are not happy about it. Then what happens? Your son is not glorified by you. And then it will also affect you. Your glory also will be hidden. But suppose when the reporters come and say, your son got 5 gold medals and you are appreciating it, you are so happy about it, you are crying and shedding tears of joy in front of them, then your son is glorified and then you are glorified and everyone will be happy about it. So now Jesus is telling, Father, glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, means he is telling, accept my sacrifice, so that the whole world will be able to accept you. Praise the Lord. So my dear brothers and sisters, right now let's close our eyes and sing together the offertory hymn and offer all the intentions that we have on this altar and pray, and the Lord is going to bless you.